An important part of vertebrate pest management is actually monitoring what's going on in the landscape, particularly if you're doing baiting programs, so that you can actually measure your success. If you're carrying out a trapping program for dingoes and foxes and cats, it's very handy before you start trapping to put some remote cameras out and actually work out what's going on. So monitoring is an integral part of vertebrate pest management, either before you start a program or afterwards to measure what's actually taking place at that landscape level. Now, there's lots of different types of remote cameras. These were developed in America, mostly for deer hunters. And so they're really based on large game animals that they're trying to detect. In Australia, of course, we're looking at using them for small animals like rats all the way through to dingoes and camels and so forth. So the piece of equipment that you choose depends on what you're trying to achieve and what sort of animals that you're trying to get images of. Now, in Australia, there's two main different types of remote cameras. We have the first type of camera, which is an incandescent camera or a white flash camera, denoted by the normal white flash that you see on normal SLR cameras and handheld cameras. And this will sense an animal moving and take a white flash photograph of that animal. That's one particular type. The other type is an infrared camera. And there's lots of different types of those. And these don't send off a white flash, they send off an infrared beam. So the image that you get back from nighttime is just a black and white, and sometimes, depending on the camera type, can be a pink coloured image. Both of these are different styles of cameras for different animals. For the white flash, it's okay if you're taking photos of animals that aren't startled by the white flash, and that if you're only trying to see them once, that's fine. But if you're trying to do long-term monitoring and looking at animals without trying to change their behaviour, a white flash doesn't cut it for animals like foxes, quolls and dogs. You need to really move towards an infrared camera. Now, there's different ways of using remote cameras, different ways of mounting them. There's different pieces of equipment that you can use. Some of these devices come with screw mounts in the back of them, so you can actually put them on a tripod. Some have a screw system that you can thread a bolt into and use them to place them on trees or on posts. Just depends on your program and how you want to use them. They can just be put up on a tree using a cord that goes through here and an octopus strap or a python strap, and just aim them down at the target. There's lots of different tools that you can use and pieces of equipment for cameras, and far too many to describe to you now, and some I'm sure you'll develop on your own. When we're actually placing them in the field, some people like to put them on a tree and put a strap through it or a python lock. We like to use just strapping, household strapping for construction. We just cut it into a piece of about that length, a few inches, drill a couple of holes out, so you can actually put it onto the back of the camera. And then here's one I prepared a little earlier. We just get a nut and a wing nut, and you can place that on the back of the camera. You can drill that into the tree, and then you can locate and allocate the camera according to where your target is going to pass by your camera. If you don't want to use that and you're just going to place them on a tree, you do need to have some wedges or some bits of wood available to angle the camera down. If you angle it at this angle here, it's not going to pick it up. The way the camera works is it actually has a PIR sensor, an infrared sensor, and it will send a little, depending on the type of camera, what we call a detection zone in front of the camera. And some of them are conical shaped. This particular brand here, the bands go across the camera, across the lens, and the detection area is a couple of narrow bands. So you need to think about that when you're placing your camera, because it's absolutely critical to getting the camera to actually trigger. Otherwise, an animal may walk past the area if it's not allocated properly and lined up properly, and the camera won't see it. So you've lost that shot. So when you're angling it against a tree, sometimes you can place a little bit of wood. I just get these door stops, quite a handy little technique, and you can slip them underneath to wedge it up or wedge it down depending on the angle of the track. But keep in mind, you need to know how your camera works when you're deploying it so that you actually get the camera to work at its maximum. Another very handy tool when it comes to trying to get the camera placement absolutely right is to use what's called, in this case here, is a little viewer. You can use a laptop, or you can buy those little digital SD card frames and use the same thing. But what it allows you to do is to set your camera up and then take some photos of a particular point on the track, and then you can take your SD card out, put it into your viewer, and see whether the angle of the camera is right. Now that's critical, because you can spend a lot of time setting up a camera only to find it's in completely the wrong place, and all you get is a couple of ears going past it, or a tail, or worse still, it's bending down to the ground and you've missed everything. So getting the detection zone right so that the field of view is perfect is critical, and these little tools are very handy. The other thing that people like to use when they're placing cameras is star pickets, for example. You can put cameras and mount them on a star picket, either with this strapping, or just bolt them straight through, or tie them up with rope. Another one you can use is to just place them on a tripod. People use these for stability in the bush. You can get all the angles covered, and they're a handy thing to have, but if you're putting out 50 camera traps like we are in a row, these just aren't a practical option, so you've got to go for placing them with strapping or straight onto the tree. But it's another tool that's worth thinking about. Now, the other thing about cameras is that they all have different settings and they vary according to the model. This camera here allows me to set up to take different numbers of photos with no delays or with lots of delays. There's a whole range of different mechanisms in different cameras that are there to suit your needs. So once again, make sure you understand how that camera works before you buy your camera, so that the functionality that you need to do your work is in that camera that you're choosing. Make sure that you don't point these towards vegetation that's going to move if you can help it. And in this case here, we've got vegetation here that I'm going to have to move out of the way. The other thing is, you don't want to face them towards the sun. So you don't want to face them to the pathway of the sun towards the north. In Australia, cameras should always be faced southerly if you can, to try and avoid the passage of the sun creating shadows across the screen and bursts of sunlight on the screen, because that will also trigger the camera to take a photograph through its heat sensing mechanism. So here I'm going to be facing this direction, which is in a southerly direction, so I won't get that sun as it comes up in the morning across this angle here to go around behind me. So I'm not going to have that problem. I've got a bit of vegetation that I'm going to move out of the way, because my direction is going to be to put the camera around here and face in that direction there, because my animals are going to be walking along this path through here, and I'm going to want to try and angle my camera directly at them. This situation here, I'm going to be using a screw and the bracket that I've previously shown you, and it's very simple. Just make sure you bend the device up firstly, so you don't get it around the wrong way. Screw goes in, and I'm just going to make sure I line it up roughly where I think it needs to be. It doesn't matter too much, because you can get the fine adjustment using the bracket. Okay, now I can move my camera and adjust it to the angle I want, so I can go up and down, I can go to the side, and I want it to focus on a point about 5 or 6 meters away from the camera. That's going to vary depending on your subject. If you're doing it for looking at quolls at a latrine, for example, you'll focus directly on centered on the quoll latrine that you're trying to monitor. I've got this set on rapid fire so that it takes sequence of photos every split second. And that allows me to get a series of images. If I get an animal moving fast, I can actually look at those series of images and use them all to try and identify what the animal is. I'm going to now just set it up and program it to see if my setting is actually right using my little viewer. So just arm the camera. And this is a particular area that people can often make mistakes when they first start camera trapping, is that they'll get everything set up and they'll spend all the time and get it sorted in the field, and then they'll get to this point here where the camera says armed, and they'll forget, and they'll close the camera up and walk away, and you come back with no photos. So every time you set a camera, make sure you have some kind of a system in place so that you turn the camera on before you leave. Okay, so that's actually going to take photos. I'm now going to move to where I want to pick up the animal, and see if it picks up any images of me, and I'll know exactly where I am on the path. In the meantime, I need to remove this out of the way as well, and then I'll check on my viewer and see how we're going. So I'm just going to take these ones off here, out of the way, and that one there, And I'll take that bark out of the way because I've actually had bark fall down and do this for 2 weeks and end up with a lot of photographs of waving bark. So I'm just now going to move through and see if the camera actually picks up images of me where I want it. So I've taken my SD card out. The size of the card depends on the camera that you're using. We're using a 2 or 4 gig SD card, and they keep lots of images. It's plenty for what we're trying to do. So now just looking at my screen, and it shows me where I've walked, and I can see that that's a perfect location. Arm the camera. And then I'm right. So hopefully over in the next 10 to 12 days of monitoring, I'll get quite a few pictures of animals on this camera and the other cameras that we've got placed back up the track.